Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our June 4th regular monthly meeting of the school board for Danville Public Schools. I call the meeting to order and ask Ms. Jordan to please call the roll.
Ms. Bryant, Dr. Campbell.
Present.
Ms. Dumps.
Here.
Mr. Gould.
Here.
Mrs. Hall.
Here.
Ms. Hughes.
Here.
Dr. Palamis.
Here. All right, you have an agenda before you. What is your pleasure on the agenda?
Chairman, we approve.
Second.
We have a motion from Dr. Campbell with a second from Ms. Hall to approve the agenda. Any questions on that? Any comments? All right, then please call the roll.
Mr. Gould.
Yes.
Dr. Palamis.
Yes.
Ms. Hughes.
Yes.
Mrs. Hall.
Yes.
Dr. Campbell.
Yes.
Ms. Bryant.
Yes.
Ms. Dumps.
Yes.
Thank you very much. This evening for our invocation and then to start the Pledge of Allegiance, Board Member Ms. Cheryl Bryant.
Can we all stand? Father Creator, we come this evening into this room to try to make wise decisions for our school system. We ask, Father, that you are with us as we endeavor to make these wise decisions. Give us the guidance we need. Give us the wisdom and discernment that we need to do so. We ask these things in your holy name. Amen. And face the flag, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. We have several sets of minutes for your approval this evening. The May 7th discipline meeting, the May 7th regular monthly meeting, and the May 21st work session meeting. What is your pleasure?
Shall I move approval?
Second.
We have a motion from Dr. Campbell to approve with a second from Ms. Hughes. Any discussion? All right, then let's call the roll, please.
Okay. Mrs. Hall?
Yes.
Ms. Hughes?
Yes.
Dr. Palamis?
Yes.
Dr. Campbell?
Yes.
Ms. Bryant?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Mr. Gould?
Yes.
Thank you very much. We now move to the consent items. This evening we have the recommendations from the disciplinary hearing panel. There is one case that I would like to pull for discussion in closed session later. That's the case ending in 179. Are there other cases?
Mr. Chairman, I would request that we remove case 180 as well.
180. All right, others? All right, then you have for consent the remaining items with the exclusion of 179 and 180. What is your pleasure?
Mr. Chairman, move approval.
Second.
We have a motion from Dr. Campbell with a second from, yes, Mr. Gould, to approve the remaining consent items. Any discussion? All right, then please call the roll.
Ms. Hughes.
Yes.
Mrs. Hall.
Yes.
Dr. Campbell.
Yes.
Ms. Bryant.
Yes.
Ms. Dumps.
Yes.
Mr. Gould.
Yes.
Dr. Palhames.
Yes. That brings us to item 4.1, the Forest Hills Title I Distinguished School Grant. Ms. Smith is going to lead that off.
The Title I school recognition and from the State Department recognizes Forest Hills Elementary School. There is a Title I Part A, or for Title I, the Elementary Secondary Education Act provides funding to school divisions and schools for programs to raise the achievement of students identified as being at risk of academic failure. The federal education law, whose most recent reauthorization is also known as the No Child Left Behind Act of 2001, requires schools and school divisions to meet annual objectives for increasing student achievement on statewide assessments in reading, language arts, and mathematics. On October 28, 2014, the Virginia Board of Education honored 40 Title I schools and two school divisions for raising the academic achievement of economically disadvantaged students. The awards were based on student performance of standards of learning, or SOL assessments, during the 2012-13 and 13-14 school years. Forest Hills Elementary School was one of the schools to be recognized as the Title I Distinguished Schools in the state of Virginia for meeting all state and federal accountability requirements for two consecutive years and achieving reading and mathematics SOL pass rates at the 60th percentile or higher. In recognition for Forest Hills earning this distinction, Danville Public Schools Title I program, and to the Forest Hills Elementary School staff, family, and students, they will be awarded $17,000. The funds may be used to support any Title I allowable programs, parent programs, services, tutoring, purchasing of funding or materials for the school and the division. Tonight, we congratulate the staff and the students of Forest Hills Elementary on this honorable award. We would like to congratulate them and thank them for all of their hard work.
Absolutely. Very good.
Thank you.
Are there any questions for Ms. Smith about this award to Forest Hills Elementary? All right, well, please convey to Ms. Lassiter and all the staff at Forest Hills how proud we are of them and how eager we are to see what innovative things they will try with this extra money.
Thank you.
All right, that now brings us to the time for public comments, where any member of the public may address the board. We do have one individual who signed up ahead of time this evening, so I will give him the honor of going first. That's Pastor Edward Pope. If you will, please, Pastor Pope.
Good evening.
Good evening.
To Mr. Chairman and board members, we are the Danville Church-Based Tutorial Program here in Danville, Pennsylvania County in Caswell. And we just thought it would be fitting to share with you all what the organization has been doing, how they excelled and how the kids excelled this year. And so we just wanted to share that with you. Ken is passing out some information that we think will be helpful. The Danville Church-Based Tutorial Program was started in 1996. This nonprofit community collaborative was initiated by Danville public administrators and officials who attended an educational conference in Arlington, Virginia. The idea was derived from a Louisiana community-based program called the Louisiana Church-Based Tutorial Program, founded by Dr. Donald Hunter, who worked in the State Department in Louisiana. The main concept was to provide students a safe haven to assist them with their homework, provide them with a snack, and reinforce good behavior and character. The Danville Public Schools flew Dr. Hunter and staff to Danville and used the train-the-trainer model, and the rest is history. The Danville Church-Based Tutorial Program has been serving the students in Danville, in Pennsylvania County, and Caswell for 19 years. We currently have 32 tutorial sites in our regions. In 2013-14 school year, we served approximately 319 students. 44% of them were males, 56% of them were females. 85% are African Americans, 14% are white and 1% are Hispanic. 210 students in K through 5, 76 students in 6 through 8, and 33 students in high school. 76% of our grade 3 reading scores were at the advanced level on their SOLs. Fact is, with a B or better. 61% of our grade 6 math scores were at the advanced level on their SOLs with a B or better. So we're proud to have established a solid working relationship with the Danville Public Schools, and we look forward to enhancing that relationship in the future. We thought this would be some news that you all would love to hear. Since you've worked so hard to try to get things in place, there are some things that's working, and together we can still do some things. Thank you so much.
Excellent. Thank you.
Ken is our executive director, because you all know.
I just like, if y'all have any questions, I'd be glad to answer any questions.
I don't have a question, but I just want to commend you all. This is just a fine example of community outreach, and I admire this, and this just makes a great impact on students. Thank you, and for all those volunteers that provide that tutoring. Great service. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to appreciate Dr. Osborne working with me and working with the agreement we have with the school system. I think it's been working out perfectly, and we certainly, I think it's just one of those matches made in heaven.
How many churches are involved?
32 sites, yeah.
The city of churches, lots of them.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
I would just like to say that the church I attend, we are also a part of this program, and it is, we have reaped benefits from the program, and for Kenny, who has been there from the genesis of this program, 19 years, I had the opportunity to go to school with Kenny all the way back in elementary school. So that's how far we go back. And to Reverend Polk, thank you for all that you've done. And just a couple of days ago, I think at the Institute, a beautiful presentation in regard to what all the different sites are doing. And I would just like to say, any church that would want to be a part of this program, it doesn't cost you anything. I think that that's the piece that is so critical. Sometimes persons or churches may think that it's going to cost them something, but actually you're giving more to the church. All you're asking for is your time. And I can't see any other better investment of time than with our kids. So thank you for what you've done. And even though Mr. Lewis, you have retired from DPS, you haven't retired from kids. So we thank you for that.
Absolutely. Others? Well, I will certainly take this opportunity to publicly thank both of you and all the wonderful folks who've been working with this program for so many years. Now, since this will be televised later, how can a family looking for an opportunity to help their child make contact with the church-based tutorial program?
Oh, thank you for asking that question. Well, all you have to do is go to our website, danvillechurchbasedtutorialprogram.com. You know, I do have all the information on those brochures, and my contact number is on there, 434-710-6100. If they want to contact me, I would love to do a presentation to that church and get them connected. I think it's an outstanding program. We got plenty of areas in Danville that could use some more sites. So we're certainly looking forward to that.
Suppose they have no internet access to look at your website. How do they get this information?
Call me.
But how do they get your phone number?
Give it again.
434-710-6100.
Thank you.
Yes.
434-710-6100. I would love to. Now, if they want to call the school board office, Val, I'll tell you right now, she knows me like a book, you know. And she's got my contact information, Senator. Solby, she has my contact information. Dr. Jennings got my contact information. I think Ms. Smith might, she might. So, please, we certainly encourage all the churches who want to do an outreach. I think it's a great, just one of those great matches that happened that works very well. We did have our annual appreciation dinner, as Dr. Campbell mentioned, who's on our board now. He's one of our new board members. Last Tuesday, and man, I tell you, it was tremendous. It was tremendous. So we certainly do. I think it's amazing. I think the tutors almost get more out of it than the kids, because it makes a difference, because they recognize they're raising their kids level. So it's a wonderful, wonderful program.
Thank you.
Excellent. So for a family looking for assistance, you've given them the contact information, and I'm going to suggest we put a copy of this at the switchboard, so even during lunchtime when they're substitute switchboard operators, they'll have all the contact information right in front of them. And I'm going to also suggest to our technology wizard that he do a on-screen label with the web address and telephone numbers.
Yes.
With your permission, we'll do that. Excellent. Thank you both so very much for being here tonight and reminding us of the wonderful work you've been doing all these years. All right, we now invite anyone else from the public to come to the microphone if you would like to address the board on any issue. Well, seeing none, then we'll close our public comment portion of tonight's meeting. That then lets us move down to item 9.1, discussion of leased property. Dr. Osborne, our interim superintendent, has been researching some possibilities and will give us an update. Dr. Osborne.
We were contacted by the attorney representing the building owner concerning our need for storage space and office space for staff, offices, and those kinds of things. There has been some interest on City Council as well as in the community concerning the Glenmore building. It is not habitable at this point in terms of having individuals have offices there. There's a new roof, but the building inside has not been refurbished since the damage from the leaking roof about 18 months ago. And so the plans were last school year to put four offices there, a conference room, a significant size storage facility, and then a restroom and those kinds of things. That did not move forward, and then the building was purchased by the current owner. Since that time, the needs of Danville Public Schools have changed, and we feel that we have sufficient office space in our current area here and downstairs, so we no longer need additional office space. And we believe that we have the opportunity to downsize some of our storage needs, because what we have been storing are things like some older student records that we really have to have fairly quick access to. The general public may not realize that many folks come to us and ask for their transcript 15 years ago when they graduated, or a diploma, or even a birth certificate that we have a copy of in our files. And so we really need ready access to those things. We also have exceptional children's information stored and other information that needs to be in a secure location, such as testing information, some Title I information, and those kinds of things that have to be kept in a locked area. And that's really what we need. We could use a small conference room because, believe it or not, we fill up quickly when we have meetings. And so we were looking perhaps at having access to a small conference room for 6 or 8 people. And so in talking with the building representative attorney, we talked about what might be available in this space, because the Glenmore building is really much larger than we now need. And there has been interest in the community, as I said, perhaps a retail space or some other kind of space for that building that would make it more usable than it perhaps would be for us. And so we looked at some space upstairs just this week. We looked at some available areas, and the way we left it was that I would bring this discussion to the school board for your input and interest. And then if there was interest expressed at the board level, then I would meet with representatives from each of the areas, instruction, human resources, and finance, to take a look and see how little space that we really need. If there are things that we can put on a desk instead of having a piece of paper, then we can do that. We still will need some absolute locked storage that is secure, that we have a key, and then perhaps our director of maintenance and operations would have a key, and the building owner, but there would not be keys among any of his staff. And so we looked at that, and there are at least 2 potential areas in this building. If you remember, we negotiated really tightly when we moved into this building, mm-hmm. and for the Glenmore building as well. However, we can negotiate even more tightly with some space here in this building so that we could cut our cost to less than 30% of what we are paying now. And so having said all that, there is great interest on the building owner's part about moving forward if the board is in agreement. I was assured no less than 3 times in an hour that the lease is ours for Glenmore. We are not being asked to leave in any way, shape, or form. This is just an interest expressed to us by the building owner.
All right. Are there questions for Dr. Osborne?
The additional space, was it just an additional conference room in the discussion with the in this building?
In this building. What we need, we want, or I would like to see us be able to distill, to cut down the amount of storage room that we need, so that we could also, if it's possible, get a small conference room at the very reasonable price that the storage space would come.
So. Other questions? I'll ask, clarify for me the cost savings. I think you're saying relative to the current monthly cost of the Glenmore property.
That's correct. There are two different factors. We pay a certain amount for the Glenmore lease, and that building is 3143 square feet. We think we can do with about 500 square feet.
Oh.
And an amount was kind of thrown out per square foot, and I asked if they would consider 50% of that amount per square foot instead of what was put forward. And I was told that I will certainly take that back to the building owner. I did say how attractive it would be to the building owner to have an additional tenant, because we are paying storage space rate rather than retail rate for Glenmore. So it could potentially be a win-win. There were questions about, well, why couldn't we just store things in a warehouse? Well, a couple of things. As good as building security is in warehouses, it's not like being in this kind of facility with different kind of ability to lock things up. And we really can't go up the street or across town or, you know, 3-10 blocks when, you know, we have a parent and a ninth grader needing a record and they need it very quickly. If we had it in this building as we had it either next door or upstairs now, we would be able to access it in the same efficient manner that we do now, and that would be our desire.
Okay. Yes, Ms. Bryant.
Clarify for me, please. I heard conference room and I heard storage.
Uh-huh. We need both.
Right, so we would be getting both in this building?
Yes, uh-huh. And we're not talking a conference room, a big conference room.
Right.
We're talking about something that is about the size of Ms. Jordan's office, you know, a small
one.
And we may have to give on that. We may just do the storage area, but with the board's...
all of those records that we've discussed would fit in that 500 square feet? That's amazing.
We stepped some places off, and I kind of, you know, as they say, eyeballed some stuff based on what we have now. And I know that Human Resources has, over at least the past 2 years, been slowly putting things on disk rather than having hard copies. So. Mm-hmm. Searchable disk.
That'll be fine until we get that EMP.
I'm sorry, say again.
I said that'll be fine until we have that EMP.
Until we have an EMP.
All right, Mr. Gould.
Mr. Chairman, Dr. Osborne, if I understand you correctly, it looks like whichever scenario we wind up settling on, we're going to have a more efficient use of space that better serves our need and significant cost savings. Is that
accurate? That is correct.
Mm-hmm. Full steam ahead from my perspective.
I'm glad to hear we're having the conversation, in particular because of the Glenmore building. I think it could be better served for the city or whatever, another use than it sitting there unused and we pay in.
Well, all the parking that where the superintendent parks mm-hmm. and where the three assistant superintendents park, the area where staff parks behind Glenmore, as well as across the street, across Golden Lake, all of that is deeded leased to us with this building.
So we do not
lease
parking.
None of that is came to us via Glenmore. And so that was kind of a selling point for me. We wouldn't have to give up if we didn't choose to.
So that's just modifying the current lease on this building that reflects the changes, the storage and the conference room, and then mm-hmm. their accepting of the us backing up mm-hmm. on the Glenmore building.
Exactly.
Better way to put that.
And if the board in its entirety wishes me to move forward, I will bring specific details as I'm able to the work session. I would like to be able to because of just the change in years, I would like to be able to wrap this up fairly quickly as the building owner and our schedule permits.
All right, other questions? All right, this is not listed as an action item, and I don't believe that the interim superintendent really needs action, but I think she could use maybe some nodding heads that would all say, keep working on this.
Yeah, go for it.
All right, so I think I see everybody nodding.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, if I may add, if you would convey our thanks to the landlord for willingness to have that conversation with us. We appreciate it.
Exactly.
They have been very responsive to our needs.
Good.
I saw, since you mentioned that, I saw the new signage for our building indicating handicap access. And it looks excellent. It will be up very soon, but it is very, very well done.
Very good. And unless there are any concerns, we will ask the superintendent to proceed with those negotiations to everyone's benefit, I believe. Thank you so much. All right, the next item up is first reading of policy 4330.10, the famous entering retirement in phases, the EREP. And this first reading tonight is maybe just a little bit premature because the two different committees of the board who have been working on this are not yet in total agreement with one another, but we're approaching agreement, I believe. And we wanted to go ahead and get it started so that we could take action at an appropriate time, presumably by the end of July, to allow the folks who are still on hold waiting for a decision on their special request this spring, try to get them an answer before the school year starts in August. So I'll begin, I think, with asking Ms. Hall to tell us where this started relative to the Finance Committee. How did the Finance Committee initially get going on this?
I believe the first discussion happened, I think it was briefly talked about at the school board retreat, but really October at our first Finance Committee meeting it was discussed. And I think it's been an ongoing discussion well before that time, way past many probably of our tenures on the school board. And it was basically in tough budgetary times, it was a way to look at something that we could it would have a fiscal impact and help our students and providing additional resources. So basically, you know, we went to the policy committee and asked them to give a proposal, and I think that's where we are now. I understand this correctly, this is not an action item, so I think we still need some more discussion before any final decision is made on this. I think according to this, there's the current plan that we would be evaluating, the policies committee's recommendation, and then the finance committee has a recommendation as well. So I think it's a good opportunity for a little bit more further discussion so that we could nail it down to a final decision, hopefully soon.
All right. And then when the policy committee began working on this, Ms. Bryant, would you like to recap the thinking of the policy committee?
As quickly as I can.
Okay.
The policy committee, of course, decided back when that the people that had signed up for this year would not be affected, nor would those people that were already on the ERIP, entering retirement in phases. So when we talked with representatives from the Finance Committee in our policy meeting, the policy committee had decided that we could live with some changes in the way it was set up in order to try to still be fair to all of our employees. And having been one of those employees, I know how we feel about the things, even though I'm not a participant in ERIP. And what the policy committee did, I'm losing my light, never mind. What the policy committee proposed was that we keep our table as it was with the A, B, C, D categories for our employees, and just to remind everybody what it was, those people that are affected by it know this. Group A, this was changed back in 2007, July 1st was when it became effective. Group A, the qualifications for ERIP, age 50 plus, 10 years plus, years in DPS with last five consecutive, and 25 plus years in VRS. The benefits under the policy would be 7 years in length at 20% of the salary that you retire with, and you had to work 10%. I'm getting mixed up with the slashes and the yellow here. Work 10% with no buy, with a buyout.
Two for one.
Or sick leave buyout 1-for-1, where they could turn in a certain amount of their sick leave and get half that, turn in twice as much and work half, I guess is the way it would work. Of course, there was also an initial period where you would qualify for this. If you worked beyond a certain length of time, then you're no longer eligible for ERIP. Group B, you had to be age 53 plus and 15 plus years DPS service with the last five consecutive. Six years of benefits with 20% being what you would get of your final salary. You would work 15% and there would be a buyout 2-for-1 allowed of your sick leave. Group C, age 55 plus, 15 years plus in DPS, last five consecutive, 5 years of benefits at 20%. Work with no buyout allowed using sick leave. And then group D, 55 plus, 20 plus years DPS, last five consecutive, 4 years of benefits with 10%, and you work your 10%, again, no buyout allowed. There were notes that went through exactly who could receive benefits, et cetera, in the policy. The policy committee suggested, because of the financial constraints that we are under, that we adjust the benefits and the requirements to earn the benefits some in order to help with our financial situation. The policy committee suggested that, let me make sure I'm looking at the right one, those in group A would still get 20% of the benefits, but instead of for 7 years, for 5 years, and that all other groups would get 15% of their salary for 3 years. And we asked the finance people here, Ms. Cassidy worked so hard for us, to give us how much of a savings we would have compared to our current plan now. The finance committee sent back a proposal to us. Would you rather talk about that, Ms. Hall, or you want me to?
You can go ahead.
Okay. They sent back a counter proposal, if you will, that all groups, A, B, C, and D, receive 15% of their salary as their benefit and get 3 years of benefits. We also have the cost savings for this plan, and the policy committee would like to suggest that we discuss at least with group A, leaving all other groups at 15% of their salary as their benefits for 3 years of benefit period. We would like to see group A get the 15% for at least 5 years instead of the three like all of the other groups, because we felt like these are our longtime employees and they have served us well, and that they deserve to have going forward at least those 5 years of benefits, since we are cutting it back from 7 anyway. As someone who has been in the classroom and knows that we're sort of the redheaded stepchildren of state employees. We're not really a state employee unless they want us to be. But our main funding comes from the state. We are not treated as state employees with all of their benefits, etc. The school board does its own benefit package. We felt like that for those long-term employees, that it would be a goodwill, faith in action, if you will, if we would at least give them the 5 years of benefits if they are in that group, because most of these people are at the very, you know, end of their careers. And, you know, teachers don't get a lot of accolades, they don't get a lot of monetary benefits, and I just think as a system, it would behoove us to show our employees, our longtime employees most especially, that have stayed beyond when they could have retired, that we are appreciative of what they've done for us in this way. So, I'm putting it on the table from the policy committee that we can do, we agree with groups B, C, and D, 15% of the salary as their benefit for 3 years benefit period, but we would really like to see the group A have not the 20% that we proposed at first, but at least 15% for 5 years instead of three. I feel they deserve that, and that's coming from someone who's been in the classroom. And Ms. Cassida also provided for us the benefit alternative proposal, the cost effectiveness, and what it would cost in the long run. And you all do have that table to look at. So it is up at some point for first reading, and those are the main changes that are being proposed. Within the body itself, the main changes in the verbal part of the policy just reflect what is in the table, but in word form. Now, there is one addition under the notes, which is table two in the policy. Table one is the ERIP groups by year of birth and years of service, which I just alluded to, A, B, C, and D. Table two is the qualifications and benefits by the group, and directly under that are the notes. One through five remain the same, but a sixth would be added, which says participants may not use accumulated sick leave to cover any part of their work requirements under the plan. And within the table, A and B, where they could buy out with their sick leave, that has been deleted and changed to no buyout allowed. When this particular type of policy went into effect around the state of Virginia, it wasn't just our school division, it was totally different than it has morphed into. And I know Dr. Osborne has talked about that at a previous meeting, so I'm not going to belabor that point. But when it first started, it was to give the long-term employees a way to go ahead and retire if they felt like they were ready to, and still use them in the classroom to our benefit by not having to hire substitutes, but instead having, for the benefit that they got each month, them work so many days per year for that yearly benefit. Not only our division, but several other divisions around the state it eventually morphed into as a secondary retirement benefit. And under that guideline, the state code more or less changed how we look at this. It is now a retirement supplement is what it is, and that's financially a little bit different. I and the policy committee would like for it to go back a little bit more of what it was in the beginning, where we can still reward the longtime employees but still benefit from their working in the classroom, you know, as substitutes or in other capacities that they are experienced in. So from the policy committee, the rest of the changes are basically to cover the table as far as the groups, et cetera, and then the eliminating of the sick leave to buy out your obligation of working the number of days that you're supposed to work each year.
Very good.
I can try to answer any questions that you might have, but remember, we're on a schedule here.
All right. The last part of the discussion relative to the ERIP participants way back in the very beginning being required to work the days that were in the program. And going back to that raises a thorny issue for the board to contend with relative to the payout for unused sick leave. Many of our recent year retirees have used it to buy their ERIP days, and so it didn't matter what the supposed dollar cost would be, they were using it for a different purpose. Given that this direction seems to be where the board is headed, we knew that we needed to take a good look then at the $15 per day that's been in place for so many years. We are toying with some options, one of which would be a greater benefit for unused sick leave days for more experienced DPS folks. So the payout for one individual might be greater on a day-per-day basis than for another who did most of their career in a different location. So we are looking still at those proposals. They will kind of have to happen in conjunction with this, but that $15 a day is not in policy. The policy basically says it's decided by the board as part of the budgeting process each year. So we don't have the restrictions and timeline that we have with an official policy of the board. So to recap, and then I'll ask board members to please express their thinking at this point on this big issue about ERIP. Last fall, we started toying with the possibility of just simply doing away with ERIP. The basic premise of helping people leave early no longer in this day and age seems to be terribly appropriate for us. We value our veteran teachers and other staff, and many of them are still in excellent health and love what they're doing. So we really question why we should be encouraging them to leave. And with the ever-decreasing pool of available new folks out there to be recruited, it's getting more and more difficult to replace all the folks who retire earlier than they might have under different circumstances. And so while the extreme possibility of totally doing away with it was discussed some, I think it fairly soon became clear that we can't just cut it off. There are too many folks who've been planning for this for too long. And so at this point, I think the two committees are pretty much in agreement on groups B, C, and D. And the real question becomes exactly how do we modify the benefits and the work requirements in group A. So the proposal that's out on the website now has Group A at 3 years of benefits, 15% of their salary, working 15% with no buyout. As you heard, the policy committee would prefer to bump up the number of years on that one. The discussion was around possibly 5 years. So we're at least getting close with the two committees, I think. So I'm going to simply ask now around the table, other board members, please speak up and give us your sense of where you want the committees to go with this now that it's on the table.
Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to break the ice on this one. I've not been shy. One thing before, a very specific comment before a more general one, that I had not realized when the Finance Committee met previously, and that is that under the proposals that are out, our year-over-year spending for Group D actually increases under each of these, and I can't support that. I can't support a reform that every one of these proposals actually costs us more in the first year than the existing program does. And granted, every one of them yields savings down the road, but I mean, I think I'm preaching to the choir when I say our budget was, for next year, as tight as a tick, and to find a couple extra $100,000 to increase the benefit above and beyond what folks in Group D thought they would be getting, I don't think makes sense from an arithmetic standpoint. And just generally, I've struggled with this a lot. I hope that we will stick with 3 years as the top end for Group A. I think that, just like you said, Mr. Chairman, we're incentivizing folks to leave, and we've got to get out of the business of incentivizing our veteran employees to leave earlier than retirement age in a lot of cases. If we are at 3 years, then a veteran employee who has reached the age of 62 would have some bridge income until Social Security began at 65. I'm not entirely comfortable with that just based on the how tight our budget is, but it's something that I could support. But to back it out farther than that, I think we're not being as good a steward as we should be of our increasingly limited resources.
All right. So a specific concern about the actual proposed increase in benefits for Group D. All right, who else would like to chime in?
I would just like to agree with Mr. Gould and also say that, yeah, I agree that we, you know, I don't want to continue to encourage our employees to leave us. I think they are our veteran teachers, and they bring a wealth of experience to our new teachers. And I would like to incentivize them to stay, not to leave. So that's basically all I'd like to share. Thank you.
All right. Other comments? All right, then tonight's discussion constitutes first reading, and we will schedule a public hearing. I would think we would do the public hearing at the work session 2 weeks from tonight, and then allowing the full 30 days would push potential action to the July work session. Everyone in agreement? All right. Then if the two committees will take tonight's comments and any other input you receive and continue working on this, we'll try to have it in a cleaner form for the public hearing 2 weeks from now. All right. Our next item on the agenda would be 10.2, the discussion on a strategic planning retreat. You've seen the information that was sent to us by Dr. Wayne Harris, and within his proposal, one of the first things we would have to decide is what day and a half that's available for him would work for us. And he has given us three possible combinations there. And just from some email reaction today, it looks like we're down to the first listed possibility. So let's start talking about July 30th and 31st. This would be probably 8:30 to 5:30 on Thursday the 30th, and then 8:30 to 12:30 on Friday the 31st. What's the availability for those two dates? All right, we're good with Mr. Gould?
It's possible.
Possible?
Yes.
Ms. Hughes, all right.
It will work for me.
We're good there. Ms. Dones?
Today it works.
Today it works. We'll settle for that. Dr. Campbell, okay. Ms. Bryant?
As I said in my email, today it works.
Great.
But it might work out because of business I do, but I might have to
yes.
be a little flexible.
Of course. All right, that sounds about as firm as we are likely to get for any dates. So unless someone objects, I will communicate to Dr. Harris that we would like to lock in July 30th and 31st. And before anybody panics, no, we're not going to leave town and go to some fancy resort. It will likely be right here in this room.
That's why we shouldn't call it a retreat. Unless you're sending me someplace fun.
Decorations. Can we have decorations?
Decorations?
Oh, we're going to play games too?
No. Not that I'm aware of. All right. Is there anything else in the proposal that you'd like to respond to? Anything that you'd like to request any changes on?
Cost.
Okay. Yeah.
I think when we're saying that we are trying to cut costs, save money, I think that we need to look at the cost.
All right. If we found a third party source to cover the costs, would that help?
That always helps.
That always helps. Right.
I believe that might be possible. I'll be glad to pursue that.
That would be good.
All right, any other issues with the proposal? All right, then if everyone will try to lock that in their calendar as best you can for July 30th and 31st, and I will check on possible funding source. And if you see anything else, we will have this for action to approve in some fashion at our work session. Is that all right with everyone?
Dr.
Okay. D. Yes, ma'am.
The publication that we're supposed to review, especially with chapters 2 and 5, is that available online at the Virginia School Boards Association site?
I have not looked to see, and I frankly don't recall getting that when I first was appointed to the board. Do others of you recall such a publication? Then we're going to need someone on staff, perhaps, to...
I remember us getting several different things, but I don't remember if these were one. This was one of the things.
All right. I don't recall seeing it either. Dr. Osborne and staff could see if they could track that down and see what it would take to get us 7 or 8 copies of that. All right. Anything else about the proposal? All right, then let's see where that puts us on the agenda. That, I believe, brings us to an action item from Human Resources on personnel recommendations. Dr. Janet, you've been waiting patiently. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Hamas, and good evening. I hope you've had an opportunity to see the second page of personnel recommendations that we had in your red folder, because there would be 2 pages now, making a total of 22 actions for which we are seeking your approval. I do want to point out just a couple of things. The case ending in 02, which is on the original page, that is a retirement that came after we had our celebration and so forth and recognitions last time. One of our administrators and I thought that I would point that out to you. And on the second page, the case ending in 14, I always like to highlight when we have found a highly qualified math teacher. I'll be happy to answer any questions you have. And if you have none, we respectfully request your approval.
Other questions for Dr. Jennings? I have one. Is case 13 proposed to come to GW in the fall?
Yes.
An alumna of GW?
Yes.
Dr. Pahamas, I do not know.
I'm almost sure she is.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Very good. So we have one of our own coming back to teach special ed. Excellent. Excellent. All right. Any other questions?
Would it be appropriate to recognize a particular person or two if...
After the vote? Mm-hmm. Any other questions for Dr. Jennings? All right, this is an action item. What is your pleasure?
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion from Ms. Hughes to approve, and the second sounded like Ms. Dooms.
Yeah.
All right, this is for the personnel.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I believe with case 02, would it be appropriate for us to add the language regarding ERA eligibility that we have been doing the last few months?
Yes, I'll take that as
yes.
A motion to amend. And can we get a second on that?
Second. How we're amending it?
We've been wording it that the ERIP application will pending until the board determines the future of the ERIP plan.
Okay, thank you.
Right?
Yes.
Okay, so that was Mr. Gould. Do a second from Ms. Dooms. All right, everyone understand the intent of the amendment for case 02?
Yes.
And that is the only one that would fall into that category.
Yes.
All right, you ready to vote on that one?
Yes, sir.
All right, then please call the roll on the amendment.
Okay. Mrs. Hall?
Yes.
Ms. Hughes?
Yes.
Dr. Campbell?
Yes.
Ms. Bryant?
Yes.
Ms. Dooms?
Yes.
Mr. Gould?
Yes.
Dr. Pahamas?
Yes. That brings us back to the main motion, which has now been amended. The main motion is to approve the personnel recommendations with the stipulation that in case 02, the application for ERIP will remain pending until the board determines the future of the ERIP program. Everyone understand? All right, any debate on that? Then let's call the roll, please.
Dr. Campbell?
Yes.
Ms. Bryant?
Yes.
Ms. Dooms?
Yes.
Mr. Gould?
Yes.
Dr. Pahamas?
Yes.
Ms. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Hall?
Yes.
All right, Ms. Hughes, I believe I know, but I'm going to let you tell us who it is you would like to recognize.
That would be one Mr. Arnold Woody.
Yes.
If he's here, would he please stand?
Mr. Woody?
Thank you so much for your years of service, Mr. Woody. And we'll try to have an appropriate certificate shortly.
She has one more.
Right.
And I'm standing here patiently, and I appreciate your saying that earlier because I sensed that you were speaking it into being, because most people know I'm not a patient person, so I'm going to try to source that. But I do have one other person I would like for us to recognize this
Please.
Evening. And with your actions, you have elected a person to serve as the division's coordinator of athletics for middle and high school programs, and that gentleman is Mr. Jonathan Bain.
Yes.
Thank you.
Excellent. And it appears that they haven't found a place to put you while you do all this. I trust they'll find some appropriate place. Very good. All right. Any others in the audience that we want to recognize?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Ms. Fulton as well, leaving us after 15 years.
Indeed.
I'm heartbroken.
I saw her early. There she is. Ms. Fulton, we are going to miss you tremendously. Thank you for the years that you have given to the students and the families of those students here in Danville Public Schools. All right, so let's see what's up next. We have a facility use fee waiver request, and Dr. Osborne is going to explain that for us.
Thank you, Dr. Pulpamus. In the spring of this year, an individual brought to us a request to use the Langston Gymnasium twice a week, beginning in May and going through the end of July. This usage was for the Southside Elite Ballers, which is a group of student basketball players. The request was for, as I said, twice a week from 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock. At the time the facility use request was given to staff, we were still determining the use for the Langston campus over the summer. We were not quite sure whether we would be using the campus for a second edition of summer school for specific students on the Langston campus, or exactly what our use would be. And we were reluctant to move forward with the uncertainty of that information. Well, later in the spring, we were approached by Warwick Scott about a summer program that he wished to have on the Langston campus, and we determined at that point the use for the campus, the gymnasium, would be a periodic use of that request, so we still did not move forward with this particular facility use request because that request would be a joint program between Danville Public Schools Mr. Warwick's group, Mr. Scott's group. And so we wanted to make sure that as partners in that summer program for our middle school students, that we did not rent the gym and surrounding area until we knew the disposition. Well, as it turns out, that program is not moving forward. And so we wanted to bring this request to you because either facility requests that come to you with fee waivers or reduction requests come to the board. What I will tell you, and you have it in board docs, each of those uses is $250 a day. So a week's use, 2 days, is $500. For the entire request, we're looking at $4,000. This is has a couple of concerns from staff. One is it's a tremendous use of one of our facilities in terms of tying up the gymnasium and surrounding areas, as well as having to have the gym at a certain temperature that we would not necessarily have the gym at all the time on these days, or during this time on these days. It will also require additional work on custodial staff because they will have to routinely clean on a more frequent schedule and delay having the gym waxed. And so this is a concern as well. Having said that, we ask this requester if he would put some information in place, such as do you charge the students, what kind of staff do you have in place, what other places have you looked, how many teams, will you have a trainer there? Will you have first aid available? Those kinds of things. And those are just the nuts and bolts things that we need to have in place just to protect ourselves from liability of someone who is not acting in an event or on an effort or in a collaborative way with Danville Public Schools. So in looking at this, we wanted to be a good partner to someone and a group in our community that had the best interest of our students at heart. But at the same time, we have an obligation to the bottom line of Danville Public Schools. We do not believe that a fee waiver would benefit us financially, and think it's not a good effort for us to recommend to the board. We would ask the board, if you are so inclined to allow a reduction in price, for you to consider no less than $100 a day for usage. And I'll be happy to answer any questions that I can. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, my question has more to do with his cover letter, which explained the reasoning for it, and one of the reasons was so that more students would be able to be involved in the programs as school teams were limited spots. But then I looked at the answers to the questions, and there would be no more than two teams with 15 players per team. So that's only 30. I didn't feel like, for the cost effectiveness of it, that few number, and there's no guarantee that those 30 people, 30 students, wouldn't already be on some team somewhere.
Well, and there was no assurance that it would be Danville Public School students.
Right. And I also had a problem with the at how he planned to handle emergencies and such. That was not, didn't satisfy me the way he answered that question.
Other questions for Dr. Osborne?
Dr. Osborne, when you mentioned the $100 per day figure, how, based on the analysis that you all have done, how close to our hard costs does that $100 per day figure come?
Barely break even.
Okay.
Is that including the utility cost? Mm-hmm. It'd be breaking even?
Barely.
Barely.
And that's just if we have a moderate. So, just looking over the last year.
Other questions?
Dr. Osborne, you talked to this individual?
Several times, yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Did he give you any indication on how many kids he may try to recruit from DPS?
All he could were his exact words.
If there are no further questions, this is an action item for your consideration. The request is for a complete waiver of fees, and you have the documentation that shows the full cost, and you have heard Dr. Osborne indicate a willingness to allow reduced fees in the amount of $100 per day. So those are three options. What would be your pleasure? Someone want to put a motion on the floor?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we decline the request for a fee waiver.
Second.
All right, the motion is to decline the request. All right, motion by Mr. Gould, second by Ms. Hall. Any discussion? All right, then please call the roll.
Ms. Bryant?
Yes.
Ms. Stones?
Yes.
Mr. Gould?
Yes.
Dr. Paul Amos?
Yes.
Ms. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Hall?
Yes.
Dr. Campbell?
Yes.
All right, we now move to the child nutrition budget for 15-16, and Ms. Ensminger will be presenting. Whoops, okay, Ms. Cassidy is going to start it.
It's a team effort, it's a team effort.
Tag team on the child nutrition.
It is. I am really excited to be able to bring you the child nutrition budget tonight. I know that's a sentence, you've never heard me use those two words in a sentence together, excited and budget. But I really am about this one because, as you will hear in just a minute, this budget will be very beneficial both financially to Danville Public Schools, but more importantly, will benefit all of Danville Public Schools students and their families. The new funding opportunity that we're presented with is called the Community Eligibility Provision, or CEP. In a nutshell, rather than requiring our families to complete the annual free and reduced lunch applications, our school division can receive our federal USDA reimbursements for meals based on an identified student percentage, or the percentage of students in our population directly certified because they participate in other federal assistance. Now I'm going to let Stacy come and explain a little bit more about the program and the exciting result of this program.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As Lori described, Community Eligibility Provision, I'll call it CEP for short, created by the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act of 2010, allows schools in economically challenged areas to offer breakfast and lunch to all students for free. How does this work? We take the percentage of children who qualify for free meals by means other than meal applications, it's called the identified student percentage, and apply a federal multiplier to determine our new eligibility rate. For our district for the coming year, that rate looks like right now that 95% of our meals will be claimed at the free reimbursement rate, and the remaining 5% will be claimed at the paid rate. This rate will be used for 4 years unless we show an increase in our identified student percentage, which then in the following year they will allow us to increase that 95 to say 98, 100%, if the data follows. Their goal is to try to get more directly certified children, have the data that the social services puts out to the state and the VDOE puts back to us. They want that match rate of like 100%. So that's their goal. What does this mean for our department? This means that though the amount of money we receive from meal sales will be lost, the increase in reimbursements more than makes up for the shortfall. The additional revenue from reimbursements, coupled with the time no longer needed for processing meal applications and dealing with unpaid meal charges, will provide us the opportunity to spend more time and effort on what we know and what we love, food and nutrition for our students. Most importantly, what this truly means is that every student is entitled to a nutritious breakfast and lunch each school day, free from stigma, and parents who struggle to pay for school meals can breathe a little easier. This is a wonderful thing for our community, and I'm really happy to be a part of it and proud to present it to you this evening. And I'll turn it back to Lori, and I'm main handy if you have any questions.
So isn't that exciting?
Yes, it is.
Did you catch that? Every child in Danville Public Schools will receive free lunch and breakfast without having to fill out any paperwork or being afraid that if they can't pay for their meal, they have to just avoid the lunch line completely or get the cheese sandwich. You know, we can avoid that. So this is very exciting, I think, for our division. If you'll look in the documents that are attached in the board docs agenda item, there are two documents. The first one with just one column of figures is the actual budget we'll be asking your approval on tonight. The second document is an actual comparison of how the budget would have looked if we were doing it the old-fashioned way now, with the free and reduced lunch application reimbursement method, or by using the community eligibility provision, the CEP. And so you'll notice that very first line in that item that the meal sales is much less under the CEP version, because the only meal sales that represents is our estimate of adult meals that, you know, adults will still have to pay for their meals, of course, and then a la carte, which means if a student wants to buy additional food, so that would they would have to pay for those too. So of course that decreases by about $317,000, but then if you'll look a couple lines down under federal reimbursement, that line goes up over $380,000. So actually, we have an increase in revenue by participating in this program. Of course, under the expense side of this budget, there is some reduction. Stacy was able to reduce some line items just for the cost of processing applications that we won't have to do anymore. those type of things. And of course, this is the first year in the program, so as next year when we're having this discussion, we may actually realize more savings by not having to do some things that we're currently doing. We may see a higher increase in the number of participation meal sales. People may actually eat more because it's free. They're participating now and not avoiding that line, as I said. Stacy has also heard that many times the a la carte sales go up because parents can afford maybe to have them buy a little extra now. They're not having to actually pay for the full meal. So there's, to me, this is just a win-win situation, and I'm very excited about it for Danville Public Schools. If you have any questions, I'm sure Stacy can help answer those, and we'll be requesting your approval on this budget for 15-16.
Not really a question, but a comment. I thought I heard Ms. Ensminger mention the word stigma, and I remember some time ago we heard information that a lot of students, especially in the upper grades who are eligible for free and reduced lunch, don't do it because they're too proud. They don't want to admit it. And I just think I'm really excited about that because, I mean, when you've got more, when they're better nourished, then they're going to think better and maybe even make some better decisions.
Absolutely. It levels the playing field there. Mm-hmm. Very exciting.
Absolutely. Other questions or comments? Mr. Gould.
Mr. Chairman, just two quick ones. Ms. Cassidy, the first is a strictly budgetary question. The increased profits that would come from going the CEP route, do those stay in a non-general fund, or do they go into the general fund just for the benefit of everyone?
It must stay within the school fund.
Okay.
And eventually those will be redirected into capital improvements, or we talked about once we see how this program works, you know, just more varied food offerings or nutrition education, those kind of things that we can enhance our program by using these extra funds.
Okay. And my other question was, I remember closer to the beginning of this academic year, there was media coverage about some school divisions, I think, opting not to go this route because there was a concern that by not having the hard data on the number of students eligible for free and reduced lunch, we might actually hurt ourselves in terms of our eligibility for other federal funds that were keyed off of those figures. I'm assuming things have changed or we're comfortable that that is not going to inhibit our ability to receive other funds.
Very good questions. When community eligibility first came out, and as Stacy said, 2010, when it was first authorized, that was it was piloted in a few states, and then it's nationwide now. But people were hesitant to participate in it for that very reason, because Title I and other federal programs were based off of our free and reduced lunch percentage. And if we didn't have those figures, what are we going to do? Well, as I figured would happen, those are federal programs, this is a federal program, they all got on the same page. And now they figured out a way to use the directly certified percentages to still apply towards Title I and E-rate that we bring to you each year, those kind of things. We've all kind of gotten that straight, so I really can't find a downside.
Perfect. Thank you.
My comment is not necessarily about this, but nutrition in general. And I think about those times when our schools are closed for bad weather. If we could have some schools open during those days. Sometimes we're closed many days and our students are without food. And I would love to see that type of program set up
definitely
in the future.
We'll be looking into that. I think that falls under a different administered by Virginia Department of Health. It's the Child and Adult Care Food Program. I think that's the only thing that covers, and we're not involved in that yet, but we're doing
could
summer
we possibly?
Feeding this summer, so we're moving in that direction.
Super. Thank you.
While you're up there, tell us a little more about the locations for the summer feeding. I know we've heard it before, but I want the public to be well aware of this.
All right, our open sites where anybody can come and we'll feed children under 18 for free are Langston, GW, Gibson, and Johnson. Those will be operating until July 30th, Mondays through Thursdays. Breakfast is 7:45 to 9, and lunch is 10:30 to 2. And everybody's ready and waiting to serve.
Excellent. Other questions or comments? Yes, Ms. Bryan.
I think it's wonderful. How will this affect going through the line? Will it speed up? at all.
We have the option to get rid of the PIN numbers, but with the a la carte sales, I didn't feel comfortable accepting any money that I couldn't account for. So we'll still be using the PIN numbers. This way, if there's a discrepancy and a parent calls us, we have something to look at and know what happened.
Ms. Enzminger, can you repeat the schools that will be providing the breakfast and lunch for the summer?
It's Gibson, Johnson, Langston, and GW.
Four locations. All right, other questions or comments? All right, this is an action item for our decision tonight. What is your pleasure?
So moved, Chair.
Second.
All right, we have a motion to approve by Dr. Campbell, second from Mr. Gould. Any discussion? Seeing none, then we'll go ahead and call the roll.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Mr. Gould?
Yes.
Mrs. Hall?
Yes.
Ms. Bryant?
Yes.
Dr. Campbell?
Yes.
Ms. Hughes?
Yes.
Dr. Paul Hames?
Yes. Thank you both very much. We are excited to see the direction that the federal government has finally figured out how to do things. Superb. All right, let's see where that puts us on the agenda. I believe that brings us down to a discussion on the possible date for the July regular monthly meeting. We had encountered a conflict last year, and so I wanted to check with everyone to see, do we still have a conflict on the date July 2nd that would be the normal date, or is it all right?
It was last year's conflict. I have forgotten.
I want to say it was Dr. Campbell.
Yes, but, and it'd be the same issue for me this year.
Same issue?
Yes.
All right. Yeah, okay. Is there any interest then in potentially moving the meeting to the next week? All right, then, hearing none, we will leave it July 2nd unless somebody proposes something at our work session. All right, then, I believe we're now ready to turn to Mr. Spencer to see what comments he would choose to make this evening.
I don't have any comments.
Okay. And then we'll turn to Dr. Osborne.
I just want to say again how pleased we are to be able to bring forth the community eligibility division for our community. We have had concerns, and when I say we, the whole staff, Ms. Enzminger has been at the very forefront of trying to see what we could do, how quickly we could get this done, and Ms. Katia Green has been our research person with this. She has done everything that she could to make sure that we would not in any way be jeopardizing any of our federal dollars. And as usual, Ms. Cassida has been right there with the money, making sure that everything that we needed to have would work for us. I feel like this is just such a plus, such a bonus for the children of Danville Public Schools. Every child can eat breakfast and every child can eat lunch, and you know, I'll be excited about this for a long, long time.
All right, will you call the roll, please?
Mr. Gould.
I just want to echo right off the bat exactly what Dr. Osborne just said. I think that the community eligibility provision is something that is truly a game changer. And I know we throw around that term about a lot of things, but when you get down to it, there's just not much in this world that's more important than making sure our children are fed. And it is so crucial to their ability to grow and succeed. And Ms. Enzminger and everyone in this building who was involved in that, I can't thank you all enough. want to thank all of our staff who helped the three graduations that we have go so smoothly. We had three excellent speakers at those graduations. Also want to recognize everyone at Galileo for their recognition as one of the top finance programs in not just Virginia, but in the country. They ranked 22nd out of all high schools in the United States in terms of their finance instruction. So we appreciate the accolades that they brought to us, and that's all I've got.
Ms. Hughes.
I'd just like to echo the things that Mr. Gould has said and just add my congratulations to Forest Hills for receiving the Distinguished School Grant. Good job. Keep up the good work. I hope everyone is having a good summer, and I hope to get some time to relax a little bit and think about what we have to come and look forward to it. Thank you.
Mrs. Hall.
Yes, I won't repeat all the comments that my colleagues have already shared. I echo those as well. I was not able to attend the graduation or any of the end of the year events. I took a family vacation, but I heard they were wonderful, and I want to personally congratulate all those graduates and to thank the parents for sharing their children with us for, 13 years of their lives. And we certainly hope that we were successful and that they will step into their next phase of life prepared. And I think this will be the last public meeting that I would like to publicly thank Dr. Osborne for her strong leadership this entire year. Dr. Jennings, Mrs. Smith, for the team that you all provided and that strong leadership. We made progress this year, and I'm grateful to all of you for your hard work. Thank you so much.
Ms. Downs.
I'm not going to repeat everything they said because I can't even remember it now. But to echo my colleagues, but I would like to personally thank Dr. Jennings, Dr. Osmond, Ms. Smith, and the entire central office staff for all they've done. Also thank those that are retiring for the services they provided to DPS. Also thank all of the DPS staff for a successful 2014-2015 school year, and have a great summer.
Ms. Bryan.
Ditto, 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 ditto. Especially thank you for the leadership this year. I really appreciate it, and the team from the admin staff. I want to say to Mr. Woody personally that I wish you well on your retirement, but I'm sorry to see you go. As a former colleague of mine, I know how hard you work, and I know it's well deserved, however. And you're retiring for your second time from something, I think. And Mr. Fain, I'm so happy for you. Congratulations. And Ms. Fulton, I'm going to miss you. I know everybody else will too. I want to thank everybody that's here, giving up your Thursday evening to be here and listen to what we do, because it's not the most fun place in the world to be on Thursday night. So thank you, and let's hope next school year is the best one that we have had in a while.
Dr. Campbell.
I want to also echo again about the tutorial program. That information was beneficial, I think, to the whole DPS and to the board and to Dr. Paul Hamus for even reaching out even more that the community can get this message of what they are doing to make our students better. And in closing, also to thank our students for listening to the call that we did not have any major pranks.
Yeah.
Minor ones, but not major ones. And so thank you for that, and to central staff, and have a wonderful summer.
Dr. Paul Amos.
This has indeed been a rewarding year in many ways. It's been challenging in a lot of ways. We've been faced with some big issues, and we've had some significant changes to deal with, but I feel like everyone from Dr. Osborne all the way down to maintenance and transportation and child nutrition have all done their part in making sure it would be a successful year for the students. And that is indeed what we are all here for. So I thank everyone who has made this a good year. I also want to thank the parents and other audience members in the three high school graduations. I felt like the atmosphere was just right. There was a celebratory feeling, but also a feeling of dignity, and that was welcomed. I would like to also remind folks that we've had some major successes this year outside of the classrooms. I point in particular to our dear friends on City Council and thank them publicly for their support of our budgetary needs and for their willingness to begin funding again the capital needs that we have for our buildings. And they've even gone a step further and brought back up the idea of a really fine stadium to serve the schools and the community. So we look forward to working with them as that idea begins to take shape without having to cut back on any of our funding of the instruction that is our primary focus. So I feel like it's been a great year. Congratulations to those who are moving to the next phase of their lives, whether it's retirement or promotion or a new job with us. We are looking forward to next fall, and it'll be here before you realize it. So thank you all. I believe we could have a motion to adjourn at this point.
I move this meeting the school board of the city of Dan.
Yeah.
Be recessed for.
You've got it right. I was wrong.
I wish
10
had
minutes.
Second. I wish you had it.
I know there's a ball game coming up.
10 minutes?
Yes, we'll say it's 10 minutes and we'll see how it works.
Second.
We have a second. Yes, we have a second from Mr. Gould. So the motion is to recess for 10 minutes. Everyone understand?
Yes.
All right, you ready to vote on that? All right, let's vote.
All right, Ms. Downs?
Downs.
Ms. Hughes?
Yes.
Yes.
Dr. Paul Amos?
Yes.
Dr. Campbell?
Yes.
Ms. Bryant?
Yes.
Mrs. Hall?
Twitch.
Mr. Gould?
Yes. Yes.
Sorry. Thank you.